educate myself again. I've got to medicate myself again. I've got to medicate myself again. 'Cause you don't need me hanging around. Yeah, one more drink and I will be right. Well, I found you broken. I got to medicate myself again. 'Cause you don't need me hanging around. You know what? I barely get my coat off and you're already crawling down my back again, again. You get to watch me sinking down. Yeah.
Of Denver City Council. This session of the Budget and Policy Committee begins now.
Thank you, my mic was off. Welcome, everyone. I'm Jamie Torres, I represent West Denver District 3. We will start with introductions on Zoom with Councilmember Flynn.
Thank you, Madam President. Kevin Flynn, Southwest Denver District 2, still recovering from COVID with my wife here at home. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Flynn. And we will move to introductions starting on my left with Councilman Cashman.
Good afternoon, Paul Cashman, South Denver District 6.
Good
Good afternoon, Kendra Black, District 4. Good afternoon, Amanda Sandoval, Northwest Denver, District 1.
Good afternoon, Joel Clark, District 7.
Amanda Sawyer, District 5.
Chris Hines, Perfect 10.
Thank you, colleagues. And we are joined by our friends from Department of Finance. Thank you all for being here to give us an update on ARPA Round 2 and some of the community outreach overview. We will turn it over to you all. And as you're coming up, I want to welcome Councilwoman Seda Baca, who's also joined us online.
Good afternoon. My name is Margaret Danuser. I'm the acting CFO, and I'm joined by my colleagues from the Department of Finance to walk you through the American Rescue Plan Act Round 2 Community Outreach Overview. Today we'll be walking through the three phases that we've employed for our community outreach, and Kiki Turner is going to walk us through those in great depth. We're also going to talk about the Stimulus Investment Advisory Committee engagement that's been done. This is the group that was put together consisting of nonprofit, community leaders, and business leaders to help advise us on our $308 million in American Rescue Plan funds. And then we'll wrap up with any questions that you have. But just to start us off, we wanted to give you an update on where we are with our first round of ARPA investments. This is as of August 10th. And just as a reminder, the first round was the first half of our funds, so $154 million. And they were programmed into various categories, including restoration of city services, premium pay for 2021, recovery programs, which is the bulk of our conversation today, some administration dollars to help get the dollars out the door. And while it says unallocated, it really wasn't unallocated. You allocated the full amount. We had $3 million that were in our restoration premium pay that didn't end up being used. So we'll talk about that a little bit more. But you can see through these categories that we do have some sizable remaining balances in that far right-hand column. And I will point us to the recovery programs column, where we have $48.8 million in recovery funds that we are expecting a sizable amount to start coming through the pipeline. HOST was allocated $28 million for affordable housing funds. And we check in with them regularly, and they said that most of their $28 million will be programmed by the end of 2022. So those balances will start to reduce as we get toward the end of the year. And I'm gonna turn it over to Kiki Turner.
Thank you so much, Margaret. Good afternoon, Council President, Council Members. Kiki Turner, the Deputy Director of Comms, the Department of Finance. Just a quick slide to orient us to where we are in this process and to visually demonstrate an important element of our outreach approach. And that's that all of the ARPA outreach we've been doing with community has been aligning directly with our annual budget process. Up until now, these have kind of been functioning in the shadows away from public eye, but as we get to the end of the fall, these will come very close together, and then we're trying to be intentional about this from the beginning, that these processes are not functioning in silos. You know, the ARPA funds do not function independently from our budget process. So we're very intentional in making sure that these two timelines align. As you'll see, we started our ARPA approach back in May with focus groups, moved to public input sessions in the June-July frame, and then have been working with our agencies to actually develop those proposals throughout the summer. So our outreach approach, you might recognize, is a little bit different than what we did last year. The federal government kind of blessed us with a gift in distributing the funds in two rounds. It gave us the chance to learn from what we did in 2021 and build on and improve that process. So in 2021, when we went out to the public, we just had what you'll see is labeled as phase two, kind of a general public input session. We felt very good about that approach. We reached a lot of residents. Who we reached actually reflected what our diverse communities look like in Denver, which was very important to us. We recognized there were two areas where we thought we could do more, given the fact that we have another year to distribute the second half of our funds. So we added what we've called phase one, which was a touch point with our community leaders, We met with focus group members, and I'll touch on that a little bit more, to kind of start the process, really let them drive what kinds of topics we take to the general public for that phase two. But we also closed our outreach session with a specific survey for our nonprofits and community groups. We recognize that as great as our investments are, if we don't have strong, well-equipped, well-resourced community partners to actually help us deploy those dollars, it's all for naught. So we kind of closed our process with phase three through a nonprofit survey. So I'll go through each of these phases kind of briefly, but those focus groups I mentioned, we met with about 75 community leaders. Some were identified from agencies. This body, our council members, had recommended and identified residents that we were able to meet with. We were conscious of making sure that our community leaders represented a variety of kind of topical areas. We had housing advocates, safety advocates, neighborhood advocates, business and worker advocates. We also got a recommendation from the Stimulus Investment Advisory Committee, who Margaret will speak to more later in this presentation. But they flagged to us that the pandemic put us in an interesting place with who was really impacted by these hardships. Certainly, there were industries that were hit hard, tourism, hospitality, the downtown corridor, and those groups have a specific set of needs and interests. But we also know that our historically underserved communities were hit, you know, disproportionately. And so we wanted space carved out for each of these groups to really vocalize what their communities and their residents needed most. So we took this kind of two-pronged approach. We met with a citywide group that was kind of our tourism, hospitality advocates. And then we met with residents who represent key recovery neighborhoods. And these are neighborhoods that we know were facing higher recovery issues and challenges based in economic realms, health realms, and educational realms. These neighborhoods were identified from the city's recovery index, which is on the Department of Finance's website. You'll see this approach kind of carry on throughout our phases of the process, but it kind of started with focus groups, giving each group space to talk and to share out what they thought was most important. What we spoke to with focus groups came from, we kind of started with them by presenting outcomes from our first process of ARPA, round one ARPA, programs we had invested in that were already seeing positive outcomes. We presented those to focus group members alongside outcomes that were identified from city council members during your briefings this spring. Many of you had offered ideas or outcomes that you thought were important for these investment dollars. So both of these were offered up for focus group members to respond to, and we kind of opened the floor and said, what are we missing? What else should we be thinking about? And through that discourse and those discussions, we landed on a variety of topics. Many of these probably look very familiar, things we know are important, affordable housing and support for people experiencing homelessness, mental health services really came to the top, small business and worker support, and then safety and community resources. So while many of our kind of our future phases of outreach, we had both surveys and discussions, focus groups stayed within that kind of qualitative realm with discussions. So all of this feedback was analyzed. We had over 500 ideas or comments or likes. Budget analysts and agencies helped us divide and then categorize and weigh what really rose to the top. And this was used as the foundation for the surveys that we took to the general public in phase two. So with that, the process will look similar to last year. We used kind of a two-prong approach. We had a digital engagement platform that had surveys, open forums, as well as educational materials, links to what's already being programmed and whatnot. But we also paired this with telephone town halls that allowed for live polling as well. So a resident could go to the website and submit a survey, or we dialed out to 120,000 residents, and people were able to, using their iPhone or a landline, were able to pull their responses to the same kinds of survey questions. We wanted to ensure that we're reaching our communities hit the hardest and our communities of color, so we took the same kind of key recovery neighborhoods that we had identified through the recovery index and specifically did our dial outs to those neighborhoods. And we ensured that the telephone town halls were simulcast in some of the most popular and spoken languages within those neighborhoods, English, Spanish, Vietnamese, and Amharic. We did a little bit extra push this year. Last year we had done about 25,000 mailers. We bumped that up this year to 50,000 translated mailers to those kind of zip codes that I mentioned that align with the key recovery index. And then we also partnered with this group. We appreciated all of your help getting this out through newsletters and e-blasts, did some social media campaigns to kind of reach residents in a variety of areas. You might remember we were able to stream the town halls to the city's website and the city's social media channels. We did get people engaging with us on social media, and all of that feedback was carried into our process. So tried to create a variety of mediums and ways for people to come meet the city where we are and have discussions about what they'd like to see with their recovery dollars. So our process this year, we had about 5,800 participants online and over the phone. We had 5,200 surveys and comments submitted. There were residents who joined the telephone town hall but chose not to actually poll, so that's kind of the discrepancy you'll see there. Across all of these different platforms, about 8 hours of discussion through the different town halls we did and the focus groups. We had almost 90 residents participate on one of our different language lines, either Spanish, Vietnamese, or Amharic. And we had a variety of residents call into the telephone town hall to share their comments live. Kind of felt like a radio show. They had the opportunity to talk to city leadership, kind of share out what they thought was most important for their communities. So across the board, the vast majority of people who we engaged with did live in Denver. We had a question whether they live or work in the city or visit for some other reason. We saw a variety of age, as young as 17. The majority of our participants were about that 30 to 49 year age. More than a third had identified as lower income. This question we asked, how worried are they about next month's rent, being able to afford next month's expenses? And over a third had said they were either very worried or somewhat worried. And we had 40% of our participants identify as Black, Indigenous, or people of color. So getting to the meat of it, I will actually bring up one of my colleagues, Will. Last year, you might remember, we had a public input dashboard. We wanted to be as transparent as possible about the feedback and the results that we heard from this process. This year, thanks to Will, that dashboard is a lot more dynamic. We got some great feedback from this body that we want to be able to zone in and zoom in on certain neighborhoods and whatnot. So the dashboard this time around not only shows the total results, but we added in a couple of key layers. One of which was looking at the results just from our Black, Indigenous, and people of color participants, and one that kind of identified key themes across our most vulnerable neighborhoods, our key recovery neighborhoods. So Will, I'll let you hop up, and he'll actually show you the dashboard live. Oh, and it looks like we lost it.
Afternoon, council members. My name is Will. I'm an economic analyst for the Department of Finance. I'll just be walking you through a quick demo of the dashboard that I created for public input. So right here on our website, all you need to do is click this link to open it up. We've also included a tutorial for this as well for the public use to make it a bit more accessible to our general community, but we'll go ahead and skip that for the purposes of this demo. So the first question that comes up is which outcome area is most important for Denver's recovery? And as you can see over here on the map, we have it mapped out by the most common response for each neighborhood in Denver. And these are all associated with these answers over here with these colors. So red being providing affordable housing and supporting people experiencing homelessness, blue being ensuring safe and vibrant neighborhoods where residents can thrive, and then this green being improving public health and mental well-being. As Kiki just stated as well, if you scroll down, you can see the results for our individual groups that we took a look at. So Black, Indigenous, people of color agreed with the majority of respondents with that providing affordable housing and supporting people experiencing homelessness was their most important outcome area. And we see the same results for our low opportunity NEST neighborhoods. Here in the bottom corner, we also see the overall results rather than on the neighborhood level. And this actually shows that there was actually a fourth answer hidden in there. It did not become the most common response in any neighborhood in and of itself, but 8.54% of respondents did answer that strengthening businesses and workers was their most important outcome. It just didn't happen to show up on the map. That's why we thought it was important to include this pie chart to get all responses for the entire community. What you can do is go to this menu over here to go through all the questions. Just another example, equity in housing, same sort of story. We ended up having different responses, the most common one being increased home ownership among Black, Indigenous people of color for this question. But we had a different answer for low opportunity neighborhoods and a different answer overall as well. So it's important to kind of get that whole picture in there. In addition to these questions, we also include our demographics, so age, ethnicity, and race among others, as well as participation, so we can see where these responses came from. This scale goes from low or no participation in white to high participation in the dark blue. with our highest participation coming from Montbello, with 12.1% of all participants coming from that neighborhood, followed by Gateway Green Valley Ranch, as well as North Park Hill. And I believe that is all. Thank you very much, Kiki. How do I get you back?
Okay. Find it, yeah.
Nope. Oh no, did I close it? Oh no.
Oh, that's okay.
Grab Sorry it. About that.
No, no, thank you so much, Will. So we can certainly share this link out to the council members after the meeting, and it is live on our website, so residents will be able to peruse it as well. So before I dig into kind of the actual responses that Will had alluded to here, I just wanted to spend one moment on what we heard from residents from open comments and what we did, which we had done last year as well. Was took all the open feedback we had. So we had transcripts from our telephone town halls, and we pulled any open comments that people shared through the website, put it through a system to kind of identify the key themes. They do align largely with what we saw on the surveys, but just wanted to flag a few items. You'll notice that the focus groups, again, kind of set that foundation, given us kind of a high-level topic. So they had identified affordable housing. What we saw kind of roll down through the public comments in this general input session were more nuanced. So things like build housing. They wanted more accessible housing to be built in the city. Wraparound services. We heard that mental health was important from the focus groups. By building out questions that spoke to those topics but dug a little deeper, we were able to uncover things like wraparound services were really important both in the mental health world but also with substance abuse and with housing supports in general. Safety was something that came up in the focus groups. Through the public comments, we were able to see a little bit more nuance, things like safety within streets, gun violence across neighborhoods, that sort of thing. So as we have been analyzing all of the feedback, we've been trying to pair the qualitative with the quantitative and looking at the open comments as well as the surveys. But jumping into those surveys, so we did start with our public at a high level, and we asked for their prioritization across a couple key recovery topics, I'll say. And as Will had mentioned, this is an instance where we saw alignment across our total results, which is what you see on the left. But we also saw that if we filter out and just look at the BIPOC results in our key neighborhoods, there was alignment there as well. So in this instance, affordable housing and support for people experiencing homelessness rose to the top. There were 10 survey questions across the outreach, across the survey, and there were 5 instances where we saw all 3 of these participant categories, I'll call it, align exactly, where the results were the same across the board. So then we kind of dug into each topic area and had 2, if not 3, more specific questions. So within public health and mental health, we asked kind of what was most important. I'll note the questions have a bit more detail, but to put it all on the slide, I've simplified it here. You can see all of the detail on the dashboard. But for our mental health topics, you know, we saw that total across the board, there was an emphasis on mental health care. If you were to dig in just to our BIPOC results, it kind of skewed more towards physical health care. As Will mentioned, sometimes there wasn't a strong enough commonality to flag it for something that would stand out in the key recovery neighborhoods. Within this kind of total, in our green response and our brown response, some of the detail that we offered residents here were things like telehealth, either for physical or mental health care, or more support for underinsured or those without insurance, as well as community-based treatment centers and culturally appropriate providers. Within each topical area, we also asked a question that was rooted more specifically within equity. This, I think, is a byproduct of the approach we took to the focus groups in the very beginning of having kind of a two-prong approach. So within each topic area, we had a general question relating to public health, housing, safety, whatnot. But then we asked residents very specifically how they think we can reach a more equitable city within this area. And sometimes the broader question result aligned very closely with our more equity-focused approach, but sometimes we did see some important differences. So within public health and equity, we saw aligned desire to create more unique and specific services for historically underserved residents. Details within this question included our veterans, youth, and people experiencing homelessness. Within our housing topic, again, this was kind of our highest ranking topical area from that very first question. We saw an aligned focus towards supportive housing for Denver's most vulnerable. This detail included wraparound services for those receiving mental health care, violence prevention services, substance misuse assistance. So we saw a need to kind of help people maintain and achieve housing kind of in a comprehensive sense, that it's not just housing alone, they need supportive services kind of across the board. Equity in housing, we saw kind of differences, and Will touched on this one, so I won't spend too much time on it, but our total results, we saw a desire to kind of help families build generational or intergenerational wealth. This, I think, does align with our blue response, our BIPOC results as well. The idea of home ownership. We know that home ownership is a way to achieve intergenerational wealth. But our key recovery neighborhoods had flagged more renter support. So it's not just owning a house, but how do I even stay in my neighborhood by renting? So within these two categories, particularly the key recovery neighborhoods, we saw that desire for kind of more affordable housing units to be built. We did kind of break up our neighborhood question. We realized that when it comes to thriving neighborhoods, there are community supports we can bring, but safety felt on its own. So this is an area where you'll see kind of three questions. The first one kind of started more higher level with just ensuring vibrant neighborhoods, and youth really rose to the top across this category. Some details within this question were things like after school programming, youth employment and youth reskilling opportunities was very important to all participant categories. Then we had a specific question about safety and safe neighborhoods. And this was the one instance across all of our 10 questions where the total result was different from kind of the BIPOC and our key neighborhood results. So both of those participant categories identified decreased gun violence as the most important priority, whereas kind of all results combined, it pointed to alternative response to assist residents in behavioral mental health. STAR was identified as an example within the details of this question. So the fact that both our BIPOC and our key neighborhoods identified this as their top priority was something significant to us that we flagged in our analysis. Equity in neighborhoods, again, we kind of see that push back towards doing more to keep people in their homes, either through helping them purchase their homes or educational and eviction support. To make sure that we can kind of reduce involuntary displacement and allow neighborhoods to remain kind of true to their character and culture. And then our last category was kind of our business and workforce category. Here we saw kind of the desire for new jobs or better opportunities for those who lost jobs, as well as support for workers. This question was really getting at retraining, reskilling opportunities. This was a moment where we saw alignment with another question, kind of getting back to our youth. People said they want reskilling and training opportunities for youth. They also flagged it as a key priority for just workers in general. And then finally, kind of getting into that even more, when we asked people about how we make a more equitable process in city for businesses and workers, that reskilling, mentorship, educational result came to the top for us. So I know it's a lot of data. That's why we'll get you the link and you can peruse the dashboard at your leisure, but kind of our takeaways from both the qualitative open comments and the surveys identified kind of four categories of results. The big, you know, big themes that arose were really within the, you know, housing and homelessness realm, supportive housing and wraparound services, and creating more affordable and sustainable access to homeownership for renters and residents across the city. This idea of wraparound services came up again a lot within our mental health category. So making sure we're providing those for people experiencing mental health crises or who are experiencing substance misuse. But the other kind of key areas were supports for women and minority-owned businesses, as well as reskilling, mentorship, and educational opportunities, youth programming, after-school opportunities for youth, and then decreased gun violence and neighborhood safety kind of rose to the top as well. So our agencies and Department of Finance have kind of taken that feedback and used it as a criteria as they're developing proposals. Margaret will kind of give you next steps on what it looks like to bring those proposals to you and to the public. But just to touch on our last phase, and it's, you know, a bit on its own, but as I mentioned, important for actually deploying these dollars in the long term. Kind of briefly touch on the nonprofit survey that we had done. There were 129 organizations across the city who completed our survey. We felt pretty good about the representation across different public serving sectors. We had a lot of turnout from nonprofits or community groups in the educational world, serving youth, kind of health, housing. We had arts and cultural nonprofits and organizations as well. We asked organizations who they predominantly serve. Low-income residents was the top result, as well as BIPOC residents. But a lot of the organizations who responded serve youth and families, immigrants and refugees, and others. We also saw a pretty great mix in the size of the nonprofits. We know that small nonprofits might have much different needs and challenges than our larger nonprofits. So about 20% of our respondents, and this was the majority answer, indicated that their budgets are between $500,000 and $1 million. We did see about 9% who said their budgets are greater than $5 million, and 13% said their budgets were less than $50,000, so quite a range there. Also of note, about 76% of these nonprofits had previously applied for city funding. So we are able to isolate a little bit and understand if you're a nonprofit who's never applied for city funding, what were your answers and how is that significant to us? So the key themes from this nonprofit survey, when it came to applying for funding, you know, we asked, had they applied for, you know, COVID-19 related funds or ARPA funds before? The greatest challenge that we saw there was just a lack of awareness about the funding opportunities. This is good for us to know. It is a bit kind of a low-hanging fruit. I think the city, we can easily do more to make sure that we are marketing and promoting these opportunities to nonprofits so they know that it's available and they can apply for the funds. Once we actually kind of got down to people who had applied for funds and asking them what those challenges were, something that came up was that nonprofits or community groups were tasked with providing services prior to receiving the dollars. And particularly among smaller nonprofits, this is hard to kind of front the cash. So again, something good for us to note going forward. And then a big response across the survey questions, the most challenging part of the process, we had focused on applying for funds, deploying funds, and reporting funds. Applying for funds was flagged as a great challenge. Organizations noted it was complex or time-consuming, redundant, a lack of staff to specifically go out and apply for grants, that kind of thing. So our Department of Finance is working closely with Human Rights and Community Partnerships, as well as Denver Economic Development, an opportunity to identify some actions that we can take to help our nonprofits. As you'll recall, we have some funds set aside already for nonprofit support, and we have plans to ensure that we're able to continue to support nonprofits going forward. So with that, I will turn it back over to Margaret, who will touch on an important body that we've been working closely with last year.
Thanks, Kiki. So we mentioned earlier in the presentation that our advisory body for our American Rescue Plan funds is the Stimulus Investment Advisory Committee. It was formed in spring of 2021. Consists of a group of community leaders, nonprofits, and business representatives. We meet monthly with them, and they help advise on everything from just this community outreach process that Kiki talked about. They were heavily involved in providing us with suggestions on who we should reach out to, as well as giving us good feedback loops on how we were proposing to go about it, as well as just the allocations themselves. So again, we meet every month, and we've met 14 times so far. And this is our membership group, which is, of course, headed by our council president. And Council President Torres joined us for her first meeting just about a week or so ago. So you can see that it is a wide representative of community, nonprofit, and business leaders that all are very, very engaged in our ARPA funds allocations. We also formed a partner subcommittee, recognizing that there are other stakeholders within our community that are certainly either a recipient of some of their own American Rescue Plan funds or maybe recipient through state funds, that we wanted to make sure that we were sharing information together to identify areas where we had overlap, areas of common interest, and areas that we might be able to leverage other funds. And so these were partners from entities such as the Denver Housing Authority, Denver Public Schools, RTD, as well as the state, to name a few. And so this has been our engagement process so far with both the Stimulus Investment Advisory Committee as well as City Council on how we have used ARPA funds for 2021. Again, we've got the monthly meeting with the SIAC committee, and we did a series of one-on-one engagements, briefings with City Council in the spring. Brendan Hanlon and I conducted those just to make sure that we were understanding what you all were looking for in the ARPA round two process, as well as where your priorities might be. We gave you an update, in May at the FinGov committee, and here we are today with our budget and policy update, leading us to our next steps. So the American Rescue Plan proposals and the 2023 annual budget are very tightly wound together and very synced up with their schedule. We've been simultaneously working on ARPA proposals as well as budget proposals because a lot of times they are very tied together. And so I just wanted to make sure that that was clear with us today. The Department of Finance will be briefing Council President Torres and Pro Tem Sandoval in the next couple of weeks to make sure that we can gain their citywide perspective on what our ARPA recommendations for round two will be. And then they will be released as part of the 2023 proposed budget by September 15th. So both the budget and the round two ARPA recommendations will be released together at that time. We'll be back before you with both of those things on September 23rd. So this is the Friday meeting for the budget overview. It will include both the 2023 budget as well as the ARPA proposals. And then when the agencies are coming before you with their budget proposals, their ARPA items will also be included in those presentations. So that is the end of our presentation. Any questions?
Thank you so much, Margaret and Kiki. Thank you also. We will start with questions with Councilwoman Black.
Thank you for the presentation. I have a question on your last slide about how it's part of the budget process. So have the agencies all come up with what their priorities are based on all this outreach? Is that correct?
The agencies received all of the work that Kiki shared with you on the community outreach process prioritization, and their proposals should be based on sort of what was provided there. Mm-hmm. So that is part of our evaluation too. Does it align with what we heard from the community? Is it eligible? Does it fit within a round one allocation, so it's a continuation of a program, or is it new? And will take us a little bit more time to get out the door. These are time-restricted funds. We have to commit the funds by December 31st, 2024, and spend by December 31st, 2026. So we want to make sure that we have the ability to get those funds out the door. So those were some of the criteria that we've used, as well as equity, making sure that our proposals have a strong equity bent. So.
Okay, so that's good to know. Then I was looking at that neighborhood recovery map, and I seem to have lost it on my computer. But I'm really curious on how that was done. Do you have it in the slide deck?
We'll have Will McBride come up and talk about that.
Yeah, okay, cool.
So, can you pull it up, or do I need to pull it up on my computer? I had it here, and then it went away. Oh, maybe. Oh, I found it.
I don't know if the recovery index is in here.
No.
On the, let's see.
This one, Council?
Yes.
So, can you tell me more about how you got this data, because I don't understand it, because it might appear like, so the white neighborhoods, the colors that are white, are those neighborhoods that aren't in need, but the darker ones are?
Yeah, so we actually right over here have our scale. So what we assigned was essentially a score from between 0 and 1.
And it was based on what?
This is based on 22 different indicators that we compiled. It includes unemployment, poverty rate, sales and use tax data to incorporate business health, among a bunch of other things. We converted it all to a 0 to 1 scale. We weighted all of them, combined them all, and these were the results of the calculations.
So I'm sure everyone else has noticed this too. So Hilltop is one of those neighborhoods, which would be quite extraordinary if they were a neighborhood that was struggling. Yeah, so that doesn't make sense to me. And it also looks like Central Park also, which I believe is one of our highest income zip codes. So I just... Yeah, so I don't really understand that.
Sure.
So
it actually takes into account a few other things. So we actually have 3 separate sections. So there is not only economic data, also health data and education data as well. If I'm not mistaken, let's check out with Central Park. We also split it up by individual census tracts as well. So as you can see with like the Sloan Lake area, you can see in the west it's doing better than the east. So we thought it was important to get down to that level as well. So it looks like with Central Park, the indicators that we included for education are the thing that's really pulling down that score. So it's not purely based on economic indicators. It has a bunch of other ones as well in there.
And you got that information from census data?
It's from a variety of sources, all authoritative through the city, through our GIS team, or through Esri, who runs the ArcGIS program and updates the American Community Survey data as well.
Okay, well, I guess generally it makes sense, but I do question some of that. I mean, Stapleton also has high educational, Central Park educational attainment, and I mean, Hilltop, so. Okay, but, so my district is far southeast Denver, and the Kennedy neighborhood and the Hampton neighborhood are always come up on every single index as a high need neighborhood, and I just bring this up in every single meeting. I feel like we're always overlooking that community. They're not an S neighborhood, they're not an inverted L. And when we do our measurements, we're leaving out a lot of neighborhoods that aren't in those categories. I know some of them are in Councilman Cashman's district too. So if someone from Dottie was looking at this map, would they look at the Kennedy neighborhood when they're working on their budget, or how would that work? Like, how would they decide, you know, to do something?
Can I mention DETO, how DETO's using this? Sure. So actually, Denver Economic Development Opportunity, they're actually using this map, and what their program, I forget the exact one they're using it for, the score that they ended up choosing actually brings in a lot of these those neighborhoods. I believe yours were included in that. Please don't quote me on that, but I believe so. But what I would say is that just based off of the colors, those don't necessarily reflect the exact scores. It's only the average of the 0.848 in there. So based purely on the colors, it may appear that some neighborhoods are doing way, way better than others. I would recommend going in there and looking at the exact numbers themselves to see whether or not the other departments have given them viability.
Okay, thank you.
I'm just gonna follow up a comment on that. And this is a recovery index that helped give us a baseline of areas of need and areas of focus for our community outreach. Doesn't indicate that the rest of the city is not included in any of our recovery efforts. It just helps us establish a baseline so that over the course of our investment time period, and we're hoping that a lot of these are a longer term investment, that we do see returns and changes over not just the period of the American Rescue Plan funds, but beyond that, so that we can identify, oh, this really worked well to address whatever it is in some area, and let's do more of it. in future budgets or future opportunities for investment. So.
Thank you, Margaret. Next up, Councilwoman Sawyer.
Thanks, Madam President. Thanks, you guys really appreciate the presentation and all of this information. I actually had the same question about the Neighborhood Recovery Index, and I was curious whether in the data that you pulled DPS data, like for applications for free and reduced lunch.
For education?
Education, we actually reached out to public schools, we did not hear back from them.
Okay. It doesn't sound like we pulled directly from them, but based on some of the questions today, maybe we can do a white paper or something on what our recovery index actually represents and how we use it.
I'd appreciate it, thank you. because, for example, Hilltop, my guess would be that Hill Middle School, which has a little over 800 students, many of them, but the majority of them are on free and reduced lunch. There's a significant portion of that school community. So my guess would be that that is in need, but lives other places, other in other statistical neighborhoods that comes to that west side of Hilltop. My guess would be that some of the data that you're using is reflective of that, and it's based on the location of the school and not the location of where they live, because otherwise that is clearly incorrect. Mm-hmm. So, if you guys could look into that a little bit more, I'd appreciate it.
Absolutely. And we think we've got our colleague, Lisa Martinez Templeton, on the line. I'm not sure it's worth bringing her in, but if you have very in-depth questions, she would be our person.
Nope, I'm good. I'm moving on, if that's okay.
Yeah,
but unless Lisa has something she wants to share, in which case, Lisa, raise your hand online, and then we can promote you in. So wanted to just ask about the distribution of the round one funds. Mm-hmm. I actually just got a call 5 minutes before committee today from a nonprofit executive director in District 5 who, we have been waiting and waiting and waiting for some of those funds to be dispersed, and we continue to wonder where those contracts are. They haven't come through committee yet. I know that the timeline to expend those funds is 2026, but the need is now. Yes. And so as much as this is fantastic feedback and information and really appreciate all of the work you're doing, but I'm just concerned that we are not getting this out the door fast enough.
We share that concern. And I'll just sort of take us back to November of 2021 is when the final round one plan was approved by you all. So we did know that it would take a little bit of time, into the first part of 2022 to start getting RFPs put together, program details put together. But I think we're starting to make sure that, we are certainly checking in with all the recipients on a monthly basis. And I've got Rory here, and he is the person that actually has those conversations with each agency to say, where are you with your process? What sort of hurdles do you have? What, are there things that we can sort of help smooth through? And just making sure that we are keeping the pressure on a little bit, keeping our foot on the pedal, because they are emergency funds. They are for recovery of our community. And we agree that they do need to get out the door.
Okay, I really appreciate that. Because I think the other thing is that for the funds that have been made public, they're gone in a hot second.
Right?
So it's like we have this sort of like dichotomy happening here where there's a bunch of funds that haven't moved at all, and then all of the funds that we have moved are accessed immediately. Which just to me indicates that there is a clear and immediate need for these funds. And it worries me that we are programming them into 2026 when, frankly, I don't think we should be programming them after December 31st of 2023. That's the immediateness of the need, right? Mm-hmm. Wondering whether part of that is the result of staff shortages, not just at the city, but also, for example, we see all the time projects that are delayed because no one is picking up the RFP for it, or you know, things like that. Do you know, are the agencies finding that challenge as well?
Rory, can I call you up here? I think we've heard some of that for sure.
Okay.
I'll let Rory speak to it more specifically.
Hi, everyone. Rory Regan, Department of Finance. Councilwoman, yeah, so depending on the specific project or initiative at hand, the reasons can be varied. Staff capacity certainly is one of them, and certain instances, whether it's on the city side or potentially on the nonprofit side as well. It just all kind of depends on what we're talking about, what agency, what initiative. Is it a new project? Is it a build out of an existing project? Depending on the circumstances, it might be any of, you know, 5, 6, 7 different answers.
Okay, appreciate that. So I guess just in terms of the number of applicants who, for the money that has gone out the door, who have been denied for various reasons, is there any sort of plan to prioritize those applications if they meet the legal requirements, right? Of course, some got denied because they didn't meet the legal requirements, fair. But for those who there just wasn't any funding left in that first tranche or whatever the case might be, is there a prioritization plan or anything like that that might help support those businesses or nonprofits more quickly?
A number of agencies actually submitted proposals for ARPA Round 2 that are kind of continuations or extensions of Round 1 programs. Okay. So where we do see a lot of demand that the existing allocation was not able to meet, in a number of instances, we did get a request for Round 2 to funding. And that would certainly be a reason, or one of the criteria that we're taking into account as we sift through those. So. I think that's kind of where we're going first, is just seeing, hey, look, can Round 2 accommodate some of these and potentially address kind of the overflow? And, you know, if that's not an option, obviously we'll have to work with the agencies to figure out an alternative solution, if that is.
Okay, appreciate that. So then I guess last question is, how can we help support you guys in getting this money out the door faster?
Yeah, I think one tangible way is we're working with agencies. We've got a monthly communications meeting with PIO and marketing staff to understand when is an RFP gonna be released? Is there any sort of news coming down the pipeline that we can try to distribute through a variety of different city channels to get the word out? I think that's probably a tangible way that City Council can probably assist agencies with just distributing some of the news about funding opportunities that exist and, you know, what we're looking for in terms of a successful application from them.
Okay, appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks, Madam President.
Thank you. Councilman Cashman?
Yeah, thanks, Madam President. just one question. So if there's a nonprofit out there wanting to get assistance with ARPA funds, is it too late for them to apply? Is there someplace specific they should direct their request if it's not?
So there were a number of nonprofit assistance awards in round one. I don't personally know sort of where those processes are. I guess it would just depend on sort of what their need was, but if you want to send us something, we can research it for you to see if there are still, if the process is still open or if it has closed. But as Rory said, if a program was oversubscribed in round one, it's a great candidate for us to look at for round two. So.
Okay, so they should make their needs known.
Yeah. Yes.
Great, thank you.
And with their respective, their agency, and I think nonprofit funds were primarily through HRCP, am I correct? Human Rights and Community Partnerships.
Okay. Thanks so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you so much. I know we had promoted in Lisa Martinez-Templeton into the panel. Lisa, I'll just kick to you if you had any comment on the recovery map or any of the data pieces.
Yeah, I'm sorry. So I'm recovering from being sick, which is why Phil is speaking on our behalf. But I did just want to remark that, much as to what Margaret stated earlier, this was really built out and intended to be a sort of a baseline for the ARPA-specific recovery and investments. So while it certainly does take an overall look at our neighborhoods in, you know, a holistic and synergistic manner, it was really tailored towards that ARPA recovery and projects and the intent of the federal funding. So a lot of those indicators under there were really selected because they serve the purpose of what the sort of federal mandate was on how we were supposed to utilize these ARPA funds. It does specifically, as Will mentioned, have some economic indicators in there, and they do come off the ACS, as well as some access to locations of public school versus private school, educational attainment, which would be 25 and older, what their education level is. And we are, we have been currently in discussions with our partners actually at TPS to get some indicator in there around third grade reading level. So this is still a work in progress. I do agree with Margaret. I think going ahead and getting out a sort of working white paper would be a really great idea. We're happy to explain it further in detail and meet with anybody one-on-one. But also, again, it is a work in progress. So as we get more projects online and moving forward, for instance, one of the indicator with health, we would anticipate that as we start having some data come in from particularly like our mental health projects, we'll start incorporating that into the map as well. So again, just really tailored for these ARPA investments, and it's certainly not intended to be a be all end all indicator of Denver's neighborhoods, but more for the ARPA. Hopefully that answers some questions.
Okay. Thank you so much, Lisa. Margaret, any final comments? We don't have any other questions in queue.
No, I think we're just looking forward to talking to you again about the ARPA recommendations that we're making for the round two allocations. As part of the budget release by September 15th, and then we'll be back before you on the 23rd. So,
great. Thank you so much. Thanks to your whole team. Thank you, council members. We are now adjourned. Budget policy. Thanks.